Waymaker, miracle worker, light in the darkness. My God, that's who you are.
You are here, moving in numbness. I worship you.
Good evening. Welcome to Wednesday in the Word. What a joy it is for us to come into your homes, into your offices, or wherever you may be, declaring the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So thankful that you have tuned in from wherever you may be, near or far, whether it's warm or to those that are in the Midwest and back East where it's a little cold. Thank you so very much for tuning in to the historic Second Baptist Church of Monrovia. I am so excited to share the word of the Lord with you on tonight. So I want you to get your Bibles, get your notepads, get your smart devices, get your pencil and paper. And I want you to meet me back in the book of St. Matthew. We're going to go back to St. Matthew's gospel and kind of pick up where we left off. But before we do that, I want to breathe a word of prayer, and I want to ask God's blessings on our time tonight. Is that all right? Praise God. Let's pray. Our God and our Father, how we thank you and praise you for this another day you have allowed us to see. Lord, we know that it is in you that we live, we move, and we have our very being. So we just bless your holy and your righteous name. We thank you, Father, for allowing us to connect virtually, God, to share your word with your sons and daughters far and near. So, God, as we come into your presence, we ask, dear Lord, that you will please forgive us for every one of our sins of thought, word, or deed. We pray and ask that you will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, God, we pray tonight that you will bless us, that you will strengthen us, that you will heal us, that you will even deliver those that are bound tonight through the power of your word. Now, Father, you know what we have need of. So we commit this time to you and we pray your blessings on us. Give us clarity of thought and God, let our word be precise that it will bring glory to your name. So Lord, do what you must do to get glory and we thank you for it now. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now, let's see. Over the last few weeks, we have been dealing with a specific topic or subject and talking about knowing the voice of God. How many of you, has that been blessing your life? I am so thankful for those of you who have reached out and let us know how you have been experiencing hearing God's voice and knowing God's voice now, and that you have been obeying and following His voice. Now, of course, we talked about the several ways. Many of you have been following it because you read the Word of God. And we praise God for that. We want to continue to read the word. Many of you, you get it on Sundays or Wednesdays because you hear through the proclamation of the gospel, through the preaching and teaching of the word of God. You hear God and you obey. But I am so excited about those of you who have been experiencing in your time of worship, in your time of meditation, in your time of devotion to God, where you are hearing Him speak to you. Listen, that is something that we all want to do every day. I told you, I want to hear what God is saying to us. Amen. So I'm thankful to you that have reached out to let us know that these teachings have been a blessing to you. Tonight, I want to pick up, as I mentioned, I want to go back and I want to go back to Matthew. But tonight, I want to pick up in chapter 26. Our dear sister, Lady Sharon Darrell, and listen, we want to continue to pray for Lady Sharon and her family. Keep them lifted up in this season, that God will comfort she and her mom and her family members at this time. But Lady Sharon did a fantastic job of closing out chapter number 25. And Lady Sharon talked about the Son of Man and how he will judge the nation. She taught that last passage of scripture in Matthew 25. And one of the things that she emphasized was she talked about how when the Son of Man comes, he's going to do the separating of the sheep and the goat. And the scriptures talks about how the sheep will be on the right side and the goat will be on the left. And that lesson, it taught us how there are certain acts of service, if I can use those words, acts of service that should befall the children of God. Sons and daughters, we should do certain acts of service. Jesus said, as you look at that, they asked the question, Jesus was sharing with them, when I was sick, you came to me. And when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me water. When I was in jail, you visited me. He gave all these things. And they said, well, Lord, when did we do that to you? And he responded, when you did it to the least of these, it was as you have done it to me. That's verses 34 through 40. You see that. And he was talking about what the sheep did. The sheep did these things, these acts of service. When we do it to the least of these, he was saying it's as you were doing it to him. Now, the goat, on the other hand, the goat had the same opportunity. When someone needed food, they didn't feed them. When they needed something to drink, they didn't give them anything to drink. When they were sick, they didn't care for them. When they were in prison, they didn't visit them. He says, when you didn't do this to the least of these, it was as you've done it to me. That passage concluded in verse number 46. And verse 46 talks about the goat and how these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Amen. Now let's deal with that for one moment. Of course, eternal punishment comes to those who have not accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Now, if Jesus is your Lord and Savior, then you have the Holy Spirit living within you. The Holy Spirit is living within you, then there should be some characteristics. There should be some traits. There should be some manifestation of your walk with God as sons and daughters of God, because you will do as God does, or you would do what Jesus did. Y'all remember years ago, they had folk would walk around with on little wrists, they had WWJD. And you say, well, what does WWJD stand? And it was, what would Jesus do? When we feed the hungry and give those who need clothes, and when you give those who are thirsty water and visit and all these things, when you do that, it's like, what would Jesus do? These are the things that Jesus would do. And as sons and daughters, these are the characteristics and traits that we would have. And as the righteous, as the sons and daughters of God, the Bible says the righteous go into eternal life. On the flip side, the goat deal with everlasting punishment. Of course, when you deal with everlasting punishment, you deal with Sheol and Hades. And of course, end result is Gehenna, which, the place of eternal fire. And that is for those who have not come to know Christ Jesus as Lord. Gehenna, of course, is a place that was prepared for the devil and his angels, and those who did not believe in Jesus Christ. That's the final judgment after the resurrection, of course, okay? So the first thing that, of course, many of us, you're here. If you're a son and daughter of God, Jesus is your Lord and Savior. Praise God. You are a sheep. So sheep hear the shepherd's voice, and we must follow and obey him. Amen. If you have not been a sheep, tonight is the night you need to come on over to the sheep side and ask Jesus to come into your heart. Let God be your Lord and let him be your Lord and your Savior, and ask our Father to lead you. Amen. Because it is not God's will for any to perish. It is not his will for that. All right. So we want to make sure that we do that so that all of us can have eternal life. Can you say amen? Great. So tonight I want to pick up and I want to pick up to begin somewhat of a lengthy time of discussion. And this lengthy time of discussion in these last three chapters of the book of Matthew, these chapters, they're going to lead to, of course, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Today, here in, the Western Hemisphere, and maybe even in different parts of the world, I'm sure it is, but many celebrate today, yet they do, as today as Ash Wednesday. Ash Wednesday. Ash Wednesday is a reminder for many of human mortality and failure. They look at Ash Wednesday and they realize it is a time and a need that they have to be reconciled back to God. Ash Wednesday is the beginning of the liturgical calendar season of Lent. Okay? Now, let me start this off. The Bible doesn't speak of Ash Wednesday, nor does it speak of the liturgical calendar of Lent. We don't see anything biblical about that. Now, of course, you'll see certain things about ash, but it was not a requirement for the sons and daughters to put ash on their heads, okay? This is a practice that is done primarily by many that are in the Catholic faith. Catholics, they celebrate this by putting ash on their foreheads. Now, this day was meant to serve as a day of penance. It's a day of penance for them. And many during this day, what they've done is they've gone to mass and they've gone to confession and things like that. And they will confess their sins and they will kind of, for some, maybe recommit to God, if you will. Some will profess their devotion to God. Now, these ashes, they are to symbolize repentance and death. All right. Repentance and death. Stay with me now. This is part of our lesson. All right. Now during this season of Lent, during this time, this period is where they were to show repentance. It's a season of mourning. It's a season of grief. It's a season of getting rid of sins, because many of them believe in Jesus. They believe in Jesus and for the death of their sins. Okay, they have some sort of faith in Jesus. All right, but over these days, more specifically, 40 days. Okay, so for 40 days, many people practice in this season of Lent. And this season of Lent is a season of brokenness. It's a season of isolation. It's a season of you are afflicting yourself. It is a season of pain, and it is a season of death. All right, stay with me now. All right. Some folk are fasting for 40 days. They say they're fasting for 40 days. They're getting rid of certain things. Some it may be a habit. I'm not gonna cuss for 40 days. Okay, for 40 days they're gonna try not to cuss. Some for 40 days they may not eat chocolate. For 40 days they're gonna try. Some people will abstain from certain things. Okay, but the challenge is, listen, if they're just doing it for this 40 day season, what happens on the 41st day? Or the 42nd day? Are they going to pick back up these habits maybe of something that they, maybe God wants to deliver them from? All right. So we look at that because this is the season of Lent. Ash Wednesday is the beginning of the liturgical calendar of Lent. All right. Lent or Lenten. All right. So once again, it's brokenness. It's death. It's pain. It's affliction. It's a isolation period. This is what this season of Lent represents. Now, if we're honest, many of us, since we've been dealing with this coronavirus, we have felt isolated because we can't do what we're used to doing. We felt pain and the sorrow and the grief, and unfortunately, there has been even death within our land. It's been a hard time, and some folks say, "Listen, Pastor, I feel like we've been in Lent all year long. We've been in the season of Lent." Now, let me put a pin in that, because can I tell you, isn't it interesting that certain seasons of life are really not predicated on the calendar, but certain seasons of life can happen at any given moment. You know, we haven't even gotten to, the seasons of, we've talked about Advent, we've talked about Christmas, we've talked about those things. You know, when it's a season where we should be overjoyed, for some, it may not be a time of overjoy, time of overjoyment. It may be a season of pain then. So when we look at the liturgical calendar, when we get to this scripture, we understand in the time frame of what we're living in is from that perspective, a season that's leading up to a time of pain and destruction, and for our Savior, even death. Right, y'all with me? So let's go to chapter number 26. Of Matthew's gospel, St. Matthew chapter 26. And Matthew is going to lead us right into the time of talking about the Passover. Are you with me? Here we go. We're going to break this. This is a long, long chapter. There are 75 verses in this chapter. So listen, we're going to eat it like you eat an elephant. You take one bite at a time. You just take a little bit at a time. And of course, I'm going to be having others maybe join in with me to teach certain parts of this. But let's just jump in tonight, all right? In this season of where it's Ash Wednesday here in the Western Hemisphere, the churches, and even around the world, Ash Wednesday, but understanding the beginning of the season of Lent, all right? Here we go. Verse number one. Now it came to pass, when Jesus had finished all these sayings, that he said to his disciples, "You know that after 2 days is the Passover, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified. Then the chief priests and scribes and the elders of the people assembled at the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, and plotted to take Jesus by trickery and kill him. But they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people." Can you say amen? All right, here we go. Let's jump in. Chapter 26 picks up at the time just before the Passover. After Jesus had finished sharing all the things that we looked at, the parable of the talents and talking about, the 10 virgins, the 5 wise and the 5 foolish, after dealing with how the Son of Man will judge the nations, he comes down and some suggest that this is it. He's entering back into Bethany, and he comes to this place after he'd finished all of these sayings. And here's what he says in verse number 2. He says, "You know that after 2 days is the Passover, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified." Stop right there. Don't rush past this verse. After all of those teachings, he says, the Son of Man, speaking of himself, will be delivered up to be crucified. Now, Jesus had forewarned his disciples in time past. He told them, "Hey, you know what? I'm going to be crucified, and in 3 days I will, I'll rise again." He had forewarned them, but here it is now. He is at the place where he's saying, "Okay, it's time now. It's coming into this time where the Son of Man will be crucified." Jesus, in essence, enters into this season, if I could say it, this season of Lent. He enters this season of Lent, but this season starts at the Passover. Let's work on that. The Passover, or the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Now, for those of you, you all know it, probably many of you, because you're Bible scholars, you know that it's called the Feast of Unleavened Bread because the children of Israel, they had no time to put leaven in their bread as they ate their final meal as slaves. They didn't have time to put the leaven in for the bread to rise. They didn't have time. They had to eat unleavened bread in their final meal. Now, this feast, it began on the 14th day of the first moon, according to Leviticus chapter 23, verse number 5. So the 14th day of the first month, some say the first month is called Abib, okay? In this month Abib, this one day is going to be the beginning of this Feast of Unleavened Bread. You can also look at Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse number 1, all right? But immediately following this day, it was the days of unleavened bread, which were 7 days. And that whole, you know, whole time, the 8 days that it lasted, they called this time, of course, the Feast of the Passover, and or the Feast of Unleavened Bread, all right? And they had this time set aside for them to remember what the Lord had done for the children of Israel. Now, before I move past that, the three most important feasts for the Israelites were three things. Now, first of all, of course, we're talking about the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which then led to the Passover, all right? You have that. That was that time for them to commemorate what had happened back in Egypt. Second important feast for Israelites was the feast where it was the giving of the law. And that was to commemorate that, and they called that the Feast of Weeks. The Feast of Weeks was the time when they would the law was given. They would commemorate that. And the third of the most important was the Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Tabernacles is when, you know, they were sojourning through the wilderness and their entrance into the Promised Land. And they remembered that, and they would have to keep the weeks or the Feast of Tabernacle. Okay. Now, when we go back to Passover, Passover is referred to as the time, listen here, that the lamb was sacrificed in Egypt, and the people of God, as they were slaves, when the lamb was sacrificed, they took the blood of the lamb and they put the blood on the doorpost of the house. So when the death angel came, when the death angel saw the blood over the doorpost, the death angel would pass over them, all right, would pass over. And of course, those of you who know what happened to Pharaoh's, the firstborn in the land, the firstborn were killed. But when the death angel saw the blood, he had to pass over. Can I pause right here? That's why it's so important that we continue to understand of the power that's in the blood of Jesus. We sing the song, "What Can Wash Away My Sin? Nothing But the Blood of Jesus." We sing the blood songs because it's because of the blood of the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world. We plead the blood of Jesus over our homes, over our families, over our lives. Can I tell you something? There is power in the blood of the Lamb, okay? So you got to understand that there's still power in His blood. All right. So Jesus says, listen here, in 2 days is the Passover. It's significant because it's out of all the time that this could have happened, that Jesus was going to die for our sins. It's so interesting that God orchestrates things in His own time. And, you know, He does things in His time because of His infinite wisdom. All right. Before, when we looked at scripture and different things, whenever the enemy wanted to plot or to maybe even kill Jesus, Jesus was able to avoid it. He was able to get out of it. You know, Luke chapter 4, it's so interesting. Luke chapter 4, verses 28 through 30 is something that I thought is really interesting when we see an example of that. Let me just read that real quick. Luke chapter 4, verses 28 through 30. Here's what the word says. So all those in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath and rose up and thrust him out of the city. And they led him to the brow of the hill on which their city was built, that they might throw him down over the cliff. Then passing through the midst of them, he went his way. Can you say amen? As I was looking that up, it's so interesting because as they were coming to kill Jesus, they were coming, he had some folk that took him up the hill and put him over the hill to get away from hurt, harm, or danger then, because it was not his time to die. But now, when we look at this passage, it was his time to prepare to die for our sins. John chapter 1 and 29, it says, that the true Lamb of God was to take away the sins of the world. That was the purpose of which Jesus came. He came to save and to die for our sins. And listen, he knew it was the time for this to happen. That's why he said in verse 2, once again, he said, the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified. Here's what's important to understand. He had already instructed his disciples. He had already told the Jews by the discourses and the things that had taken place. He had already edified them. He had already given them examples of things that they were to do. He had already shown and convinced them by the miracles that he had performed. And now he was preparing them, listen, to let them know he was going to redeem them with his blood. He was going to die for the sins of the world. He's preparing them for his crucifixion. I told you this is the season, listen here, of Lent. Watch what happens now in verse number 3. The Bible says, then the chief priests and the scribes and the elders of the people assembled at the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, and plotted to take Jesus by trickery and kill him. Stop right there. Now, Caiaphas serves as the high priest, and he was the high priest from AD 18 through AD 36, Caiaphas. Now, I know you said, Pastor, well, what does that matter? It's interesting from a standpoint of history and a timeline, because this was considered a little longer run of those who were in high priests. This was a little longer time than most of those who stood in that office. Okay, some suggested that it was because of his close relationship with Rome, and that he was connected to the Herodian dynasty. But whatever the reason, Caiaphas was in that position longer than most people as the high priest. Now, Caiaphas was one, he controlled the temple, and Caiaphas, he profited, and he was profiting from corruptness, from the things that were going on in the temple that were not pleasing to God. And, you know, he was doing merchandising, and he was, you know, probably getting broke off, you know, by some of the stuff that was happening. Now, those of you who've been with us, you remember over in Matthew, I think it's Matthew chapter 21. Yeah, Matthew chapter 21, verse number 12. Let me read this. This is what happened. Then Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple, and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. Stop right there for a moment. Amen. Here it is. Now, Jesus had gone into the temple, and Jesus is turning over tables. Jesus is whipping them out of their seats because, you know, they come into God's house and they're doing, you know, business, you know, not even good business in the house of the Lord. Okay. Now, Caiaphas was probably upset because this was messing with his money. Okay, and Caiaphas had probably, built up some sort of enmity against Jesus because Jesus had shut down all of these business dealings in the temple. You know, Caiaphas was one that probably just was like, hey, I need to get this brother. I'm tired of this. And I thought about it. Can you imagine, in spite of all of the great things that Jesus had done, all of the healings, all of the miracles he performed, all of the feeding that he had done to the thousands of people, this guy wanted to kill him for being right. Let me help 18 of y'all. Somebody, you may be going through some challenges, and you say, well, Pastor, I don't know why I'm experiencing you know, such hardship. I don't know why I'm going through these challenging times. I've been doing right. I've been serving. I've been giving. I've been loving. I've been doing the things I'm supposed to do. Why does it seem like people are coming against me? Can I tell you, you have an enemy who comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy. He doesn't want to see you do right. But child of God, I just want to declare to you, listen, if they did it to Jesus, listen, he went about doing good. And here it is, Caiaphas was plotting to do trickery and to kill him. But can I tell you, Caiaphas could not touch Jesus until it was the time for God to allow everything to take place. That's the same word I want to give to you. The enemy can only do so much, but God, listen, has raised up a standard. God has been protecting. God has been blessing. Man, I'm getting excited. God has been keeping the enemy at bay. He can only do so much because God's got you covered. And can't nothing happen to you or I unless God allows it to be so. Can you say amen to that? Now, let me get to the last verse I want to get to tonight. Here's what happened. Verse 5 says something interesting. But they said, after Caiaphas was planning his trickery, but they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people. Can you say amen? Now, let's work on this. Those Jewish leaders who had been eager to kill Jesus, they were plotting, they were planning for so long to do it. They had to postpone their plot to kill him until it was a more opportune time. This is some good stuff. It was unusual for them to want to postpone something because, you know, these were the leaders, and when they wanted something to happen, they would make it happen. The Jewish leaders, they were eager to kill Jesus, but they said, we're postponing. When you look back and study some of the things that happened for Jews, you know, when they would punish criminals, they would do it many times at public festivals. But the challenge is with Jesus, they didn't want this to happen, because if they would have tried to come and kill Jesus at this public festival where many of those people have been healed or fed, or Jesus had done, you know, performed some kind of miracles, he had all of these followers, they were afraid of, you know, some insurrection. Man, they were afraid of an insurrection taking place, okay? I wish somebody else would have thought about that, about dealing with an insurrection, but that's a whole nother sermon. Caiaphas knew that our Lord had become very popular, and it may have caused an uproar, the Bible says, an uproar among the people. Child of God, can I tell you something? It was actually the providence of God. I've already told you that God, there are certain things, the enemy can only go so far. And then unless God allows and permits certain things to happen, the enemy can't do anything. Y'all, listen, y'all remember the story of Job, right? Okay, listen, there's so far he can go, and then he's got to shut it down. He could not kill Jesus at that time because they were worried about the people. But I come to tell you that they couldn't plot and plan and kill Jesus because it wasn't his time. So many things are going on in your life. Can I tell you something? And I want to hang my hat here tonight. There's certain things that the enemy can't do unless God allows them. Certain things you got to know. God still has purpose and plan for your life. There was still some more that when we're going to get to it over these next few weeks that Jesus had to do. Could it be that they couldn't get to him because it wasn't time? God wanted him to do a few more things. Child of God, tonight, as we just lay in the foundation, just easing into this time, understand that you may be in a season of Lent. You may be going through some brokenness. You may be going through some hardships. Child of God, I want you to know that God has not left you. He promised to be a very present help in the time of trouble. He promised never to leave or forsake us. So he's with you. He is with you in the midst of what you are going through. I want to encourage you in this season where we may be challenged in some areas to look to the hills from where our help comes from. Psalm 121 says, I will lift up mine eyes to the hills from whence cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. Our help is in Christ Jesus. Tonight, maybe you've been looking for help in a whole lot of other places. Maybe you've been looking for help from people. You've been looking for help from government. You've been looking for stimulus checks that will help, and they'll be a blessing. Amen. But our true help comes from the Lord. Tonight, if you have never given your life to the Lord, I want to encourage you. There's going to be a number that says prayer. I beg you to give your life to the Lord tonight. Text that number. There are going to be some men and women of God who want to pray with you, who will lead you into asking Jesus to come into your heart. And listen, he will come into your heart and he will forgive you of your sins. Text that number right there. Maybe you say, Pastor, I'm already saved. Jesus is my Lord. But I've been dealing with some stuff. I've got some issues and some challenges, and I need someone to pray with. Text that number. Text that number. We want to pray with you. Amen. I want to, before I close out in prayer, I was pondering something on today. In this season of Lent, although, listen, as I mentioned, when we look at it, some people give up certain things for 40 days, all right? They'll give it up, and many of them will pick it back up. But here's a question for some of you, and I don't know who this is for. What in this season are you willing to give up and not pick back up for the Lord? What, as you enter in this season, what is it maybe that God is encouraging you to let go of? It may be hard. You're in the season of Lent. It may be painful, but what is it? For some of you, it may be, who is it? What is it? Who is it that you know? Listen, let me say this. I ain't telling you go divorce nobody. Don't y'all call a church talking about the pastor told me it's okay to leave you. No, don't you do that. But you know, if there is something, or maybe there are just some, you know, some friendships and that are not beneficial to your life. It's keeping you from thriving in God. It's keeping you from serving like you know you should. It's keeping you from being all that God has called you to be. What or who are those things that you need to cut off in this season? Maybe you got a bad habit, a bad vice of some sort, whatever that is. I want to encourage you. There's a number to pray, but I encourage you in your time, ask the Lord to deliver you from that or from them. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this time, Lord. I have given your people what you have given me tonight to lay this foundation as we enter into this 26th chapter of Matthew. Now, I pray, Father, that you will touch and encourage the sons and daughters of God on tonight. Bless your people. Strengthen them. Those that are sick, I'm asking that you will heal tonight in the name of Jesus. Father, we need you. God, some of us are hurting, and God, we don't know what to do. We have felt like we've been in Lent for a long time. Tonight, I pray, God, that you will just stretch out your merciful hand and touch. God, bless my brother. Bless my sister, God. Be with them. Let them feel you. Let them know that you are near, God, and you will be a very present help. So I just lift them up to you tonight. I pray, dear God, that you will continue to have mercy on those that we know, God, are dealing with coronavirus or cancer, dealing with heart issues and challenges in their physical body. Father, tonight we pray that you will ease the aches and pains. Father, and our lives are in your hands. So Lord, you are able to rebuke the death angel for our sake. Nothing can happen to us, God, except you allow it to happen. So God, we just trust you and we commit ourselves to you. Now I pray for them. I pray for those that are on the front lines that are working, God, the nurses and doctors and caregivers. We lift them up before you, God. I pray tonight that you will continue to be with them. Those that are working, God, and in other areas, God, that you will just protect your sons and daughters as we travel up and down the highways. Those that must travel over the airways, be with them. I pray for, God, the younger people, that you will remember them, God, our young adults, God, our single parents. I pray for them tonight, God, that you will continue to give them your grace and your strength. Bless our teens and our children, God. Let them not give up, Father, in this time where it seems to be overwhelming as they're tired of Zooming and all that. Give them your strength. God, give them the grace that they need. Now, Lord, there's so much more to pray. I pray for our nation and our land. I pray, God, that you will continue to be with our leaders. God, that you will help them to make wise decisions so that there may be peace in our land. So we thank you. We praise you. Now, God, continue to bless this house and not only this house, but every church door opened in your name. I pray for pastors and leaders, God. I pray that you will undergird them with your hand. God, give them the strength. Give us the wisdom. Give us the knowledge and understanding that we need. But Lord, I pray for Second Baptist Church. I thank you for this wonderful body of believers. I pray that you will continue to lead us and guide us, cover us and keep us. God, bless us to be a blessing to others. Now, Lord, there's so much more we can pray, but we commit our time and commit this time to you. And we thank you for being with us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Praise God. That is our time on tonight. I pray that you have a wonderful week in God. Continue to read your assignment. Of course, read in Matthew chapter 26, but continue to read and hear the voice of God. I didn't even ask y'all how many of y'all did your homework, and you're starting to read biblical personalities and how God is speaking to you through them. I didn't ask that. Did y'all do it, though? Okay. Anyway, our announcing clerk is going to give you some more announcements that are coming, and we just want you to be blessed. Know that we love you with the love of the Lord, and there ain't one thing you could do about it. And if the Lord should tarry his coming and the creek don't rise, we look forward to seeing you again on this coming Sunday at 10:45 a.m. Invite somebody. They'll be blessed. God bless you. Yeah!
If you don't have your Gazette, you're missing out. Text the word Gazette to 626-495-3020 to get your Seconds Gazette newsletter today. Seconds Gazette, writing history one month at a time.
Philippians 1 and 3. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. 2 Peter 3:18. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. These are biblical references referred to as we thank God for these individuals who have united with Second Baptist Church. You might say, well, who are they? Well, you have to tune in on Sunday, February 21st to find that out, because Sunday, February 21st is New Members Day. Let's celebrate these new members and the growth of our church family. Tune in and be blessed.
Need your help to spread the word. Teen Summit 2021, Saturday, June 26, 2021. RSVP if you want to be a part of the summit, which will be hosted virtually and with limited seating capacity.
Chip is back. See the announcement or social media for more information.
Join a Zoom call hosted by Dr. John Harris at 7 p.m. every Thursday. Check our social media posts for more information.
God's Word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. So join us at 7 p.m. for Wednesday in the Word.
Second Baptist Church Children's Ministry welcomes all children to join its Zoom church service every Sunday at 10 a.m. Please call the church office for Zoom link to join the service. Every Sunday on Zoom, our staff nurtures, educates, and feeds the minds of our children. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Dr. John Harris is the director of our ministry to children. Don't forget, call the church office for Zoom link and join us on Zoom.
Has this ministry been a blessing to you, and now you would like to be a blessing to this ministry? There are three ways that you can give. You can download the Give Plus app and search Second Baptist Church in Monrovia. You can go to our website, sbcmonrovia.org/give. Or you can send in a check, P.O. Box 479, Monrovia, California, 91017.
And those are your announcements for this week.